The Main Library presents Whitman Himself, The Modern Man I Sing, with Richard Kuss.
Leaves of grass. I celebrate myself, and what I assume, you shall assume. For every atom belonging to me as good belongs to you. I loaf and invite my soul. I lean and loaf at my ease, observing a spear of summer grass. Whitman himself, or at least the spirit of Whitman, resurrected in a library talking to friends. You know, while roaming the halls of the New York Historical Society, I found a first edition of Leaves of Grass, published by myself when I was 36 years old, placed on sale July 4th, 1855. And it was only 95 pages long, but they caused Emerson to rub his eyes. And 100 years later, your critic, Malcolm Cowley, referred to it as the buried masterpiece of American writing. And now today, unburied after 100 years. Oh, the grass keeps growing. The goosebumps I felt as I opened my original first edition with its dark green covers, with no author's name on the cover. Oh, just the title, Leaves of Grass in Gold Rustic Letters, which had many roots growing down and many, many leaves sprouting up. And inside, this picture of a working man. Again, no name. Is he the man of the book? He faces the title page, Leaves of Grass, Brooklyn, New York, 1855. Still, no author, no publisher. Is it this young man speaking to us? Stop this day and night with me, and you shall possess the origin of all poems. You shall possess the good of the earth and sun. There are millions of suns left. You shall no longer take things at second or third hand, nor look through the eyes of the dead, nor feed on the specters in books. You shall not look through my eyes either, nor take things from me. You shall listen to all sides and filter them from yourself. Turning the title page, in very small print is the copyright. Entered according to Act of Congress in the year 1855 by Walter Whitman. And I, Walter, I was typesetter and layout man, self-publishing without a desktop computer. I begin with no contents page, but with a prose preface. It is followed by 12 poems, pages 14 through 95. And there are no titles for each poem, just my songs flowing from the final thought of that preface. The proof of a poet is that his country absorbs him as affectionately as he has absorbed it. Clear and sweet is my soul, and clear and sweet is all that is not my soul. Lack one. Lacks both. 140 years ago, a critic of the book wrote, "First be yourself what you would show in the poem." I was the critic. As a newspaper editor, I loved writing my own reviews. Well, I only wrote three, a majority of the favorable notices. You see, I was two men, really. I wanted to be in real life the role I was creating in the book. As early as 1848, I had written in my notebooks, I cannot understand the mystery, but I am always conscious of myself as two, as my soul and I. And I reckon it is the same with all men and women. Huh? Now the man I created in the book speaks body to soul. I believe in you, my soul. The other I am must not abase itself to you, and you must not be abased to the other. Loaf with me on the grass. Loose the stop from your throat. Not words, not music or rhyme I want, not custom or lecture, not even the best. Only the lull I like, the hum of your valved voice. A child said, "What is the grass?" Fetching it to me with full hands. How could I answer the child? I do not know what it is any more than he. I guess it must be the flag of my disposition out of hopeful green stuff woven. Or I guess the grass is itself a child. The produced babe of the vegetation. And now it seems to me the beautiful uncut hair of graves. Tenderly will I use you, curling grass. It may be you transpire from the breasts of young men. It may be if I had known them, I would have loved them. It may be you are from old people and from women and from offspring taken soon out of their mother's laps. And here you are the mother's laps. Oh, this grass is very dark to be from the white heads of old mothers, darker than the colorless beards of old men, dark to come from under the faint red roofs of mouths. Oh, I perceive, after all, so many uttering tongues, and I perceive they do not come from the roofs of mouths for nothing. I wish I could translate the hints about the dead young men and women, and the hints about old men and mothers and the offspring taken soon out of their laps. What do you think has become of the young and old men? And what do you think has become of the women and children? They are alive and well somewhere. The smallest sprout shows there is really no death. And if there ever was, it led forward life and does not wait at the end to arrest it and cease the moment life appeared. All goes onward and outward, and nothing collapses, and to die is different from what anyone supposed, and luckier. Has anyone supposed it lucky to be born? I hasten to inform him or her it is just as lucky to die, and I know it. I pass death with the dying, and birth with the new-washed babe, and am not contained between my hat and my boots, and peruse manifold objects, no two alike, and everyone good. The earth good, and the stars good, and their adjuncts all good. I am not an earth nor an adjunct of the earth. I am the mate and companion of people, all just as immortal and fathomless as myself. They do not know how immortal, but I know. You see, I was my own press agent as well as critic, and I circulated my book to other writers. Concord, Massachusetts, 21st July, 1855. Dear sir, I am not blind to the worth of the wonderful gift of leaves of grass. I find it the most extraordinary piece of wit and wisdom that America has yet contributed. I have great joy in it. I find incomparable things said incomparably well as they must be. I greet you at the beginning of a great career, which yet must have had a long foreground somewhere for such a start. I rubbed my eyes a little to see if this sunbeam were no illusion. R.W. Emerson. Oh, well, not too many people agreed with Ralph Waldo, but for some transcendentalists like Thoreau and Alcott, Oh, the poet, John Greenleaf Whittier, after having read my first edition, threw it in his fireplace. Oh, God. But what was my long foreground somewhere? Ah, I was born May 31st, 1819, and named Walter Whitman, Jr. I was the second of nine children in the town of West Hills, Huntington, Long Island. Dutch and English stock, Quakers. My father was a farmer and a house builder and a friend of Tom Paine. Oh, my mother, I wrote, well begotten and raised by a perfect mother. I went to public school until the age of 12, when I was apprenticed to the printing trade. Oh, we were a close family. But nevertheless, at 14, I was on my own and worked as a printer in New York City until the Great Fire of 1835 burned me out of a job. In 1836, at the age of 17, I was a school teacher at East Norwich, Long Island, and later I taught at Hempstead and Babylon, Long Swamp, and Smithtown. Oh, and the days on the beaches, declaiming Homer and Shakespeare. So ended my formal education. At 22, I returned to New York and in 1841 as a typesetter for the New World. But then I became a newspaper man, a writer and an editor for the Statesman, the Democrat, the Long Island Star, and many, 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 many others as I pounded the blab of the pavement of Manhattan, absorbing its people and places, its plays, and especially the Italian opera. And oh, yes, there were the Broadway omnibuses with their drivers. Oh, how well I remember them. Sitting up on top alongside these men with their teams of horses. Riding the whole length of Broadway, listening to some yarn, or perhaps I declaiming some stormy passage from Julius Caesar or Richard. Oh, you could roar as loudly as you chose in the heavy, dense, uninterrupted street bass of Broadway. Oh, yes, yes, I knew all those drivers then. Broadway Jack, dressmaker Balky Bill, Old Elephant and his brother, Young Elephant. There were hundreds, hundreds. They had immense qualities, largely animal, eating, drinking, women. You know, I suppose the critics will laugh heartily, but the influence of those Broadway omnibuses and the drivers undoubtedly entered into the gestation of Leaves of Grass. Also at this time, I had published a rather routine temperance novel, Franklin Evans or The Inebriate. Finally, in 1846, I became editor of the Brooklyn Eagle. At age 27, Walter Whitman, journalist. Ah. Oh, it was during those years I got rather involved with politics. Yes, yes, yes. You too, Walter, the journalist. You see, I was invited by the bosses at Tammany to speak before 10,000 people in New York City. After the Mexican War, the nation was expanding and I was politically a free soiler. We believed slavery should not extend to any new territory. And this man I was creating knew where he stood on the fugitive slave law. The runaway slave came to my house and stopped outside. I heard his motions crackling the twigs of the woodpile. Through the swung half-door of the kitchen, I saw him limpsy and weak, and went where he sat on a log and led him in and assured him, and brought water and filled a tub for his sweated body and bruised feet, and gave him a room that entered from my own and gave him some coarse, clean clothes, and remember perfectly well his revolving eyes and his awkwardness, and remember putting plasters on the galls of his neck and ankles. He stayed with me a week before he was recuperated and passed north. I had him sit next to me at table. My firelock leaned in the corner. But times change. We all know that. And as the journalist, Walter Whitman, my free soil editorial policy no longer suited the publishers of the Brooklyn Eagle, after 2 years, I was fired. Now, we know that game all too well today, Walter the journalist. There are those who would suppress us, keep us hidden. Imagine me keeping my thoughts to myself. But in 1848, I was still the journalist, writing in the past tense. I had yet to become the poet, writing in the present tense, uninhibited by society's curtains. 28 young men bathed by the shore. 28 young men and all so friendly. 28 years of womanly life and all so lonesome. She owns the fine house by the rise of the bank. She hides handsome and richly dressed aft the blinds of the window. Which of the young men does she like the best? The homeliest of them is beautiful to her. Oh, where are you off to, lady? For I see you. You splash in the water there, yet stay stock still in your room. Dancing and laughing along the beach came the 29th bather. The rest did not see her, but she saw them and loved them. The beards of the young men glistened with wet. It ran from their long hair. Little streams passed all over their bodies. It descended tremblingly from their temples and ribs. The young men float on their backs. Their white bellies swell to the sun. They do not ask who seizes fast to them. They do not know who puffs and declines with pendant and bending arch. They do not think whom they souse with spray. So, age 29, and I'm out of a job again. A failure. These are the thoughts of all men in all ages and lands. They are not original with me. If they are not yours as much as mine, they are nothing or next to nothing. This is the grass that grows wherever the land is and the water is. This is the common air that bathes the globe. This is the trill of 1,000 clear cornets and scream of the octave flute and strike of triangle. I play not a march for victors only. I play great marches for conquered and slain persons. Have you heard it was good to gain the day? I also say it is good to fall. Battles are lost in the same spirit in which they are won. But job hunting. In New York City, I managed an out-of-town engagement with a $200 advance. So with my 14-year-old younger brother Jeff in tow, we left my Manhattan and journeyed by train, stagecoach, steamboat to edit the New Orleans Crescent. This is the meal pleasantly set. This is the meat and drink for natural hunger. It is for the wicked just the same as the righteous. I make appointments with all. I will not have a single person slighted or left away. The kept woman and sponger and thief are hereby invited. The heavy-lipped slave is invited. The venereal Lee is invited. There shall be no difference between them and the rest. Do you guess I have some intricate purpose? Well, I have. For the April rain has, and the mica on the side of a rock has. Do you take it I would astonish? Does the daylight astonish? Or the early red star twittering through the woods? Do I astonish more than they? This hour I tell things in confidence. I might not tell everybody. But I will tell you. New Orleans. New Orleans. Something happened there. Oh. I kept my biographers strangely in the dark. Some say a woman. I wrote to one of my biographers, though unmarried, I have had 6 children. 1 living grandson, fine boy. Well, circumstances have separated me from intimate relations. I exist as I am. That is enough. If no other in the world be aware, I sit content. And if each and all be aware, I sit content. I am the poet of the body, and I am the poet of the soul. I am the poet of the woman the same as the man, and I say it is as great to be a woman as to be a man, and I say there is nothing greater than the mother of men. I am he that walks with the tender and growing night. Well, after 3 months on the job, and with the very, very homesick younger brother, Jeff, we returned from New Orleans on the water spine of America. Yes, we plodded back northward, up the Mississippi, and around to and by way of the Great Lakes, to Niagara Falls and Lower Canada, and finally returning to central New York and down the mighty Hudson. In my preface, I wrote, the United States themselves are essentially the greatest poem. Was it New Orleans? Was it the journey? What was turning the newspaper man into the poet? Walt Whitman, an American, one of the roughs, a cosmos, disorderly, fleshy, and sensual. Eating, drinking, and breeding. No sentimentalist. No stander above men and women or apart from them. No more modest than immodest. By God, I will accept nothing which all cannot have their counterpart of on the same terms. Through me, many long dumb voices. Through me, forbidden voices, voices of sexes and lusts. Voices veiled, and I remove the veil. I do not press my finger across my mouth. I keep as delicate around the bowels as around the head and heart. Copulation is no more rank to me than death is. I believe in the flesh and the appetites. Seeing, hearing, and feeling are miracles. And each part and tag of me is a miracle. Divine am I inside and out. And I make holy whatever I touch or am touched from. The scent of these armpits is aroma finer than prayer. This head is more than churches or Bibles or creeds. In Brooklyn again, I built a new home for my parents and my family at 106 Myrtle Avenue. But I use the storefront office on the ground floor for a free soil newspaper. The Free Man. As editorial policy, in the first issue I wrote, we shall oppose under all circumstances the addition to the Union in the future of a single inch of slave land, whether in the form of state or territory. Well, I campaigned for the free soil ticket of 1848. But all we managed was to split the Democratic Party and gave the election to the Whigs. Zachary Taylor. Now, we radical free soilers drifted. My paper, The Free Man, went under. Now the Democrat press was closed to me. I tried getting by submitting pieces to my friends, William Cullen Bryant of the New York Post and Horace Greeley of the Herald Tribune. Then on March 7th, 1850, fearing the South would secede from the Union, the great Daniel Webster made his speech in support of Clay's compromise resolution regarding slavery in newly formed states. And by September, Congress accepted it. Free soil was compromised. As the journalist Walter Whitman, I wrote, quote, "The representatives of the people must never forget that they are only representatives and that their duty is to act in the interest of all, not to tyrannize. The duty of the citizen, on the other hand, is not to obey, but to make his will respected." Oh, yes, yes, I renounced politics. I dote on myself. There is that lot of me and all so luscious. Each moment and whatever happens thrills me with joy. My voice goes after what my eyes cannot reach. It provokes me forever. It says sarcastically, "Walt, you understand enough. Why don't you let it out then? I think I will do nothing for a long time but listen." I merely stir, press, feel with my fingers, and am happy. To touch my person to someone else's is about as much as I can stand. Now I became the poet Walt Whitman. By 1851, I stood for art and artists against the materialism of the American people and the worship of the dollar. The example I now proposed was Socrates, and greater than Socrates, Christ. I now was writing in the leaves of my notebooks, "Whoever degrades another degrades me, and whatever is done or said returns at last to me." I had left the newspapers of Manhattan, went back to house building with my father and my brothers. But I wasn't the best of workers. I was writing my book. I was a dreamer and a scribbler. I believe a leaf of grass is no less than the journey work of the stars. And the pismire is equally perfect than a grain of sand and the egg of a wren. And the narrowest hinge in my hand puts to scorn all machinery. And a mouse is miracle enough to stagger sextillions of infidels. I think I could turn and live a while with the animals. They are so placid and self-contained. They do not sweat and whine about their condition. They do not lie awake in the dark and weep for their sins. They do not make me sick discussing their duty to God. Not one is dissatisfied. Not one is demented with the mania of owning things. Not one kneels to another nor to his kind that lived thousands of years ago. Not one is respectable or industrious over the whole earth. In my preface, as the poet, I express my personal credo, making the man in the poem the man in the world. This is what you shall do: love the earth and sun and the animals, despise riches, give alms to everyone that asks, stand up for the stupid and the crazy, devote your labor and income to others, hate tyrants. Argue not concerning God. Have patience and indulgence toward the people, and read these leaves in the open air every season of every year of your life. Re-examine all you have been told at school or church or in any book. Dismiss whatever insults your own soul, and your very flesh shall be a great poem and have the richest fluency, not only in its words, but in every motion and joint of your body. Behold, I do not give lectures or a little charity. What I give out of myself. Oh, despairer, here is my neck. By God, you shall not go down. Hang your whole weight upon me. I am he bringing help for the sick as they pant on their backs. And for the strong, upright men, I bring yet more needed help. I know perfectly well my own egotism, and know my omnivorous words, and cannot say any less. My words are words of a questioning, and to indicate reality. Early on, before my leaves, I had read the writings of my master Emerson, referring to America as, I quote, an asylum of all nations. The energy of Irish, Germans, Swedes, Poles, and Cossacks, all the European tribes of the African and of the Polynesians, will construct a new race. Unquote. And now I knew. I was simmering. Emerson brought me to a boil. It is time to explain myself. Were mankind murderous or jealous upon you, my brother or my sister? I am sorry for you. They are not murderous or jealous upon me. All has been gentle with me. I keep no account with lamentation. What have I to do with lamentation? I am an acme of things accomplished, and I an encloser of things to be. I tramp a perpetual journey. Shoulder your duds, and I will mine, and let us hasten forth. Wonderful cities and free nations we shall fetch as we go. This day before dawn, I ascended a hill and looked at the crowded heavens. And I said to my spirit, when we become the enfolder of those orbs and the pleasure and knowledge of everything in them, shall we be filled and satisfied then? And my spirit said, no. We level that lift to pass and continue beyond. Oh, you are also asking me questions, and I hear you. I answer that I cannot answer. You must find out for yourself. Oh, my words itch at your ears till you understand them. I have said that the soul is not more than the body, and I have said that the body is not more than the soul, and nothing, not God, is greater to one than oneself is. And I call to mankind, be not curious about God. For I, who am curious about each, am not curious about God. No array of terms can say how much I am at peace about God and about death. I hear and behold God in every object, yet I understand God not in the least, nor do I understand who there can be more wonderful than myself. Why should I wish to see God better than this day? I see something of God each hour of the 24 and each moment then. In the faces of men and women I see God. And in my own face in the glass, I find letters from God dropped in the street, and everyone is signed by God's name. And I leave them where they are, for I know that others will punctually come forever and ever. And as to you, death, and you bitter hug of mortality, it is idle to try to alarm me. And as to you, life, I reckon you are the leavings of many deaths. No doubt I have died myself 10,000 times before. And do you see, my brothers and sisters? It is not chaos or death. It is form and union and plan. It is eternal life. It is happiness. Do I contradict myself? Very well. I contradict myself. I am large. I contain multitudes. I sound my barbaric yawp over the roofs of the world. I bequeath myself to the dirt to grow from the grass I love. If you want me again, look for me under your boot sole. You will hardly know who I am or what I mean. But I shall be good health to you nevertheless, and filter and fiber your blood. Failing to fetch me at first, keep encouraged. Missing me one place, search another. I stop somewhere waiting for you. For this second edition, I wrote 20 new poems. Now 32 poems and 340 pages. Oh, the grass keeps growing. And in the copyright, Walt has officially replaced Walter, but still the same carpenter photo. Yet conformity appeared. It was a book like any other book. A table of contents, titles, and numbers for the poems. The untitled first poem I now called Poem of Walt Whitman, an American. It would be years before I would call it Song of Myself. And in this edition of 1856 was Sundown Poem, wherein I talked to you who were yet to be born. You know it as Crossing Brooklyn Ferry. Crowds of men and women attired in the usual costumes, how curious you are to me. On the ferry boats, the hundreds and hundreds that cross, returning home, are more curious to me than you suppose. And you that shall cross from shore to shore years hence are more to me and more in my meditations than you might suppose. What is it then between us? What is the count of the scores or hundreds of years between us? Whatever it is, it avails not. Distance avails not, and place avails not. I too lived. Brooklyn of ample hills was mine. I too walked the streets of Manhattan Island and bathed in the waters around it. I too felt a curious, abrupt, questioning stir within me. I too had received identity by my body. That I was, I knew was of my body. And what I should be, I knew I should be of my body. It is not upon you alone that the dark patches fall. The dark threw its patches down upon me also. Nor is it you alone who know what it is to be evil. I am he who knew what it is to be evil. I too knitted the old knot of contrariety. Blabbed, blushed, resented, lied, stole, grudged. Had guile, anger, lust, hot wishes, I dared not speak. Was wayward, vain, greedy, shallow, sly, cowardly, malignant. The wolf, the snake, the hog, not wanting in me. The cheating look, the frivolous word, the adulterous wish, not wanting. Refusals, hates, postponements, meanness, laziness, none of these wanting. Closer yet I approach you. What thought you have of me now, I had as much of you. I laid in my stores in advance. I considered long and seriously of you before you were born. Who was to know what should come home to me? Who knows, but I am enjoying this. Who knows for all the distance, but I am as good as looking at you now, for all you cannot see me. I also included an open letter to Emerson in the appendix of this second edition. Oh, I was feeling my oats. I wrote him that sex must be brought out of concealment into the open in order to foster a sane, healthy attitude toward this important phase of life. Spontaneous me, nature. Know once for all, avowed on purpose wherever are men like me are our lusty, lurking, masculine poems. Love thoughts, love juice, love odor, love yielding, love climbers and the climbing sap. Arms and hands of love, lips of love, phallic thumb of love, breasts of love, bellies pressed and glued together with love. Earth of chaste love, life that is only life after love. The body of my love, the body of the woman I love, the body of the man, the body of the earth. Soft forenoon airs that blow from the southwest. The hairy wild bee that murmurs and hankers up and down, that grips the full-grown lady flower, curves upon her with amorous firm legs, takes his will of her, and holds himself tremulous and tight till he is satisfied. The consequent meanness of me, should I skulk or find myself indecent, while birds and animals never once skulk or find themselves indecent. The greed that eats me day and night with hungry gnaw till I saturate what shall produce boys to fill my place when I am through. The wholesome relief, repose, content. And this bunch, plucked at random from myself, it has done its work. I toss it carelessly to fall where it may. And in that letter to Emerson, I said how much I enjoy making poems. But other work have I set for myself to do. To meet people in the States face to face and to confront them with an American rude tongue. In poems and speeches, will I say the word that has got to be said? But now the journalist had much to say. The election of 1856 was contested over the question of whether slavery should be extended into the recently formed territories of Nebraska and Kansas. You see, in 1856, there were three major presidential candidates. Then as now, huh? Yes, three. Millard Fillmore, the Whigs, Americans, the Know-Nothings. James Buchanan, the Democrats, and John Charles Fremont for the new Republican Party. It was in the Republican Party that we drifting radical free soilers hope to find our political place. I wrote a paper, its purpose to preserve the Union by a reform of the political system. I called for a working class democracy. Well, the 18th presidency. At present, the personnel of the government of these 30 millions in executives and elsewhere is drawn from limber-tongued lawyers, very fluent but empty, feeble old men, professional politicians, dandies, dyspeptics, and so forth, and rarely drawn from the solid body of the people. Every trustee of the people is a traitor, looking only to his own gain and to boost up his party. The births, the presidency included, are bought, sold, electioneered for, prostituted, and filled with prostitutes. The president eats dirt and excrement for his daily meals and likes it and tries to force it on the states. As to what is called the fugitive slave law, insolently put over the people by their Congress and president, it contravenes the whole of the organic compacts and is at all times to be defied in all parts of these states, south or north, by speech, by pen, and if need be, by the bullet and the sword. You young men, American mechanics, farmers, boatmen, manufacturers, and all work people of the South, the same as the North, you are either to abolish slavery or it will abolish you. But this matter of deep personal conviction was never published. Buchanan, the Democrat, was elected in 1856. I turned my life back to my art, my poems. Walter, the journalist, you sure had trouble keeping a job. Did your poetry, your thoughts, your behavior get in the way? Survivor. I was summoned to Boston, where for the first time an edition of Leaves of Grass was to be published, not by myself, but by the established firm of Thayer and Eldridge, Boston, the hub of literary America. This photo now appeared opposite the title page. Well, this was to be an extremely organized work, a lifetime's work, at age 40. 456 poems. And this blue-covered edition of 1860 has chapter headings in bold face on the contents page. It has an architectural sense to it, but it was still personal. I used a copy of this blue book as a workbook for years, editing poems, always making changes, always rewriting, always accepting change as a way of life. Here are the lines printed on the page. American mouth songs, those of mechanics, crossed out with handwritten rewrites declaiming, I hear America singing the varied carols I hear. Each one singing his as it should be, blithe and strong. Oh, and one of your favorite poems is first introduced in this 1860 Blue Book edition as A Word Out of the Sea. It opens, out of the rock's cradle, out of the mockingbird's throat, the musical shuttle, out of the boy's mother's womb from the nipples of her breasts, out of the ninth month midnight. Yes, yes, the grass keeps growing. You know the poem as out of the cradle endlessly rocking, out of the mockingbird's throat, the musical shuttle, out of the ninth month midnight. Oh, this penciled blue book was the book that was to prove trouble in years to come, when after 6 months as a clerk in the Office for Indian Affairs of the Department of the Interior, my boss, Secretary James Harlan, discovered this book on my desk and, reading it, fired me. Another job lost through free expression. Well, so much for fame. I was hired in ignorance of my writing and fired after reading the book. Yes, I, as the poet Walt Whitman, purposely was outspoken, telling it like it is. When I came to Boston prior to the publication, I met with Emerson, the man who was my champion. Emerson, who also had told me, there are parts of the book when I hold my nose as I read. Well, Emerson now strongly suggested that the sexual section of the book entitled Enfants d'Adam, which I later changed to Children of Adam, this should not be published. I recalled my reaction to Emerson from Specimen Days. More precious than gold to me, that dissertation. It afforded me ever after this strange and paradoxical lesson. Each point of Emerson's statement was unanswerable. No judge's charge ever more complete or convincing. I could never hear the points better put. Then I felt down in my soul the clear and unmistakable conviction to disobey all and pursue my own way. What have you to say to such things? Said Emerson, pausing in conclusion. Only that while I can't answer them at all, I feel more settled than ever to adhere to my own theory and exemplify it. That was my candid response. Whereupon we went and had a good dinner. Referring to these poems under the heading of Children of Adam and Calamus, Thoreau said, it is as if the beast spoke. Now, do you understand? Even in those days, sex was vital to life. I wanted it to be a vital part of my verse. In Children of Adam, I wrote of amativeness, the love of man and woman, of procreation. Placed in this section was a poem from the earlier 1856 edition. A woman waits for me, she contains all, nothing is lacking. Yet all were lacking if sex were lacking, or if the moisture of the right man was lacking. Without shame, the man I like knows and avows the deliciousness of his sex. Without shame, the woman I like knows and avows hers. Now I will dismiss myself from impassive women. I will go stay with her who waits for me and with those women that are warm-blooded and sufficient for me. I see that they understand me and do not deny me. I see that they are worthy of me. I will be the robust husband of those women. And I carried the sexual theme further in the section entitled Calamus. Adhesiveness, the love, the comradeship of man for man. I had discovered this reality in life. I put it in my leaves. Whoever you are holding me now in hand, without one thing, all will be useless. I give you fair warning before you attempt me further. I am not what you supposed, but far different. Who is he that would be my follower? Who would sign himself a candidate for my affections? The way is suspicious, the result uncertain, perhaps destructive. Therefore, release me now before troubling yourself any further. Let go your hand from my shoulders. Put me down and depart on your way. Or else by stealth, in some wood for trial, or back of a rock in the open air. For in any roofed room of a house I emerge not, nor in company, and in libraries I lie as one dumb, a gawk, or unborn, or dead. But just possibly with you on a high hill. First watching, lest any person for miles around approach unawares. Here to put your lips upon mine, I permit you. With the comrade's long dwelling kiss, or the new husband's kiss. For I am the new husband, and I am the comrade. It had been suggested that I lost my job at the Brooklyn Times as sexual problems found their way into my editorials. Yes, I had written calling for the legalization of prostitution. It is needed. And yes, I was in love with a man whose name no one will ever know. But I confess to you in my verse, I am indifferent to my own songs. I will go with him I love. It is enough that we are together. We never separate again. But we did. Love is not always returned. He did depart. The tone of my verse, my life, was changed again. Oh, in 1855, I was the youthful egotist. In 56, I enjoyed the sexual battle against Puritanism. But now, in the 1860 edition, at age 40, the mood was one of negation, depression, and personal tragedy. Yes, now the man was aging, and the poet wasn't so sure of the world, of himself. A hand mirror. Hold it up sternly. See this it sends back. Who is it? Is it you? Outside, fair costume, within, ashes and filth. No more a flashing eye, no more a sonorous voice or springy step. Now some slave's eye, voice, hand, step. A drunkard's breath, unwholesome meat is flesh, venereal ease, flesh. Lungs rotting away piecemeal, stomach sour and cankerous. Joints rheumatic, bowels clogged with abomination. Blood circulating dark and poisonous streams. Words babble, hearing and touch callous. No brain, no heart left. No magnetism of sex. Such from one look in this looking glass ere you go hence. Such a result so soon. And from such a beginning. Body and soul, Walt Whitman. Lack one, lacks both. I needed all my strength, my will, to stand up to the media of 1860. Emerson had warned me to cut sex out. Yeah, but the dirtiest book is an expurgated book. Under the headline, Smut in Them, the Springfield, Massachusetts Republican wrote in the issue of June 16, 1860, oh, and I quote, those passions which degrade men and lead to 9/10 of the crime of the world he exalts. It will be sought out and laughed over by lewd women and prurient boys and hoary-headed old lechers. This notice of his volume will stir to read it only the dregs of the social and moral world into which it goes. That settles the question. When men and women are led by their higher affinities, they will be led straight away from Walt Whitman's leaves of grass. So Walt, the poet, at age 40, not knowing what more is in store for me with Lincoln coming, with the war coming, with old age coming. I say so long to you, my friends, at the conclusion of the third edition of Leaves of Grass, the Blue Book of 1860. So long. Camarado, this is no book. Who touches this touches a man. Is it night? Are we here together alone? It is I you hold and who holds you. I spring from the pages into your arms. Decease calls me forth. Oh, dear friend, whoever you are, take this kiss. I give it especially to you. Do not forget me. I feel like one who has done work for the day to retire a while. So long. Remember my words. I may again return. I love you. I depart from materials. I am as one disembodied, triumphant, dead. Oh, Walt, 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 didn't anyone ever teach you life begins at 40? No. I wasn't to leave you so soon. I had much more to do. Much more to sing. Much, 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 much more. Thank you. Thank you.